Hello, we've pored over the Tories' budget book, but how would Labour make its sums add up?
Is this an election-winning budget?
The last spring budget before the ballot box passed almost without a hitch, in the hope it could help the Tories' chances of keeping the keys to this front door. This pair making the case for another tax cut for working people.
There is a big reduction in the tax bill for ordinary families, and that is because the economy has turned a corner.
The surprise was an eyebrow-raising promise to get rid of national insurance completely.
Our long-term ambition is to end this unfairness.
After Mr Hunt's promise last Sunday to get taxes on a lower path. But this week, what's Labour's rival plan for the economy at the election? We'll hear from the chess champ in line to be the country's first woman in charge of Britain's budget.
The truth is, taxes are still going up. People feel worse off because they are worse off.
So this morning, we have one big question. In what direction would Labour drive the economy? Well, the woman in charge of Labour's calculator, Rachel Reeves, who wants to be the next chancellor, is here. The budget promised extra cash to get more bang for taxpayers' bucks in the health service. We'll ask the Health Secretary, Victoria Atkins, what difference that will make. And what's it like when your body won't do the amazing things you used to do? The lead singer of Delamitri tells us that Parkinson's hasn't stopped him taking to the stage. Morning. Helping me out at the desk for the next 60 minutes, the chef and green campaigner, Hugh Fearnley-Whittingstall, is back with us. Dame Sharon White, the boss of John Lewis, and Lord Michael Howard, the former Tory leader and one-time shadow chancellor. A very warm welcome to all of you. Let's start, as ever, with what is making the news this morning. The Sunday Times says Boris Johnson went to Venezuela, but it has Rachel Reeves there unveiling her big business squad, including the former governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney. We'll talk to her about that a bit later. The Observer and the Sunday Telegraph both trail ahead to the government's plans to redefine extremism coming in the next few days. The Sunday Mirror shows Esther Jai, Brianna's mother, starting her campaign for mindfulness in schools that she told us about in the studio a few weeks ago. And finally, the Mail on Sunday has Princess Diana's brother, Charles Spencer, talking about his difficult childhood. He will be with us next week. But what I reckon will be the headlines everywhere in the next few hours is this picture we can show you. It's just been released by the royal family, showing the Princess of Wales and her children for Mother's Day after weeks of frenzied speculation about her health and her whereabouts. Let's talk straight away to the BBC's Daniela Ralph, who can tell us more about that now. Daniela's in the newsroom. What has happened here?
Yes, hi, Laura. That photo that you're now looking at has just been posted on all of the Prince and Princesses of Wales's social media accounts. It's a new image. It was taken in Windsor earlier this week. It is where the Princess of Wales has been recovering, of course, at her home in Windsor. The circle around her has been very small, limited to close friends and family in recent weeks. So no official photographer was brought in here. That photo of the princess with her children was taken by her husband, the Prince of Wales, in Windsor. It is an informal image. The princess appears to look well in that picture. She often releases a photo on Mothering Sunday, so it was obviously decided that this was the moment for her to dip back into the public spotlight. And Kensington Palace will be trying to manage the narrative around the princess's recovery here a little bit and prove what they have said all along, that she is doing well, but wants her recovery largely to happen in private. And the guidance on when we will see her back on royal duty remains the same, that is after Easter.
Daniela, thank you very much. And no doubt that picture, that image will be everywhere in the next few hours. There'll be plenty of coverage of that across the BBC for the rest of the day. Our main event, though, this morning is to talk about the economy. Now, let's start, Hugh, with Jeremy Hunt's turn at the dispatch box with the budget on Wednesday. You're a Green campaigner. Was there anything in it for you?
Almost nothing. A little extension of the windfall tax. Mm-hmm. On oil and gas companies, but as we already know, it's full of loopholes. It actually encourages them to pay, not to pay the windfall tax by investing further in new gas and oil. And obviously might mean something if the required investments to not pay the tax were in renewables, but they're not. They're for more gas and oil. Interestingly, while the rest of the economy is completely flatlining, what we might call the net zero economy is growing. It's at 9% growth at the moment. I haven't heard the Chancellor mention that ever. Still less do anything to give it a boost in the budget. So, hugely disappointing.
Michael Harrod, what did you make of Jeremy Hunt? I mean, it was a big political moment as well as a big economic moment.
And it was the, if you take the national insurance contributions together, the biggest tax cut since Nigel Lawson's budget of 1988. So I think Jeremy Hunt did the most that he could responsibly do. Look, we've been through the pandemic. We've got the war in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. These things have to be paid for. And I'm sure he'd have loved to do more, but I think he did the most he responsibly could. We have turned a corner, and I think if we carry on this path and with this plan, we can see more tax cuts in future.
Well, that's certainly what lots of people on the Conservative benches hope for. But Sharon, you're the boss of John Lewis now, but you're a very senior figure at the Treasury too. We're about to talk to Rachel Reeves. What do you think the outlook for her is after Jeremy Hunt's statement this week?
I think whoever wins the election, whoever's Chancellor after the next election, has got one of the toughest jobs in the economy, one of the toughest jobs in politics. You compare the inheritances compared to 1997, mm-hmm. obviously tax burdens rising, concerns about public services, and something I feel very strongly about is also what's happened with living standards. So once you strip out the effect of inflation, living standards won't have recovered their 2008 level until 2025.
And that's a pretty extraordinary statistic, and we've talked about it a lot in this studio, and we talk about it a lot from our viewers. People are getting in touch all the time telling us how hard they've been finding it to make ends meet. We'll be back with all of you in a few minutes' time. Well, the main event, as we've just heard last week, was Jeremy Hunt's budget. There he is with his red box, the 15th Conservative budget in a row. That is an extraordinary statistic. It's not since 2010 that there's been a Labour Chancellor. Alistair Darling, there he was outside Number 10, one of the mentors of Rachel Reeves. Now, she hopes it won't be too long before she gets the job. Let's talk to her about that and what she might do if Labour wins the election, which is still an if. The election is still a long way away, in political terms at least. Let's start, Rachel Reeves, with what you call the National Wealth Fund. Now, the idea of that is that the government would stump up about £7 billion to then encourage private sector to start putting money in. You've got the former Bank of England governor, Mark Carney, coming on board, and the chief executive of Barclays. All your cozying up to the city seems to have had an effect.
Well, the National Wealth Fund is a key component of our growth plan. And Britain has never had a National Wealth Fund before. And the idea is to leverage in private sector investment alongside a government endowment to invest in some of the jobs and industries of the future, from carbon capture and storage to green hydrogen and green steel, floating offshore wind and so much more. Areas where we can be a world leader, where we can bring good jobs, paying a decent wage to Britain, start to bring people's energy bills down and also boost our economic security by boosting our domestic energy security. And I'm really pleased that what businesses can see is that Labour have a serious plan. We are determined to get in that private sector investment, and they want to work with me and the Labour Party on how we can get that up and running if we are fortunate enough to win the next election.
But you said there, though, this is about getting green energy, green jobs, these things. But some of our viewers might think, well, if that's really what you were trying to do, why did you ditch your big promise to spend £28 billion a year on that?
Well, when I first announced the Green Prosperity Plan, interest rates were 0.1%. We hadn't had the Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng mini-budget. And I had to be honest with people that the damage that the Conservatives have done to the economy will affect what an incoming Labour government can do. But I've been working with businesses to look at how we can leverage in private sector investment to do the things that we want to do and need to do to get our economy growing. Because unless we can grow our economy and boost productivity and investment, we haven't really got a chance to turn around the living standards that Sharon White was just talking about. And I am determined to be the chancellor that lifts living standards whilst also investing again in our public services.
Let's talk then about what you said then. You had to be honest with people, and I know that's what our viewers want from the people who come to the studio. I'm sure that you were pleased that the Tories took your plan to close loopholes for so-called non-doms, wealthy foreigners who don't pay as much tax here as they might. But that decision by Jeremy Hunt leaves you £2 billion short of your plans to pay for breakfast clubs at schools and extra appointments in the NHS. So where's that £2 billion going to come from?
Well, first of all, it is utterly humiliating that in the Chancellor's final budget, as you say, 15 budgets now since the Conservatives came to office in 2010, it's taken them this long to abolish a gaping loophole in our tax system.
Where are you going to get that money from? That's what our viewers want to know.
Yes, so the government made these announcements on Wednesday, and I'm now going through all of the government documents to identify the funding stream to honour those commitments. And those commitments are to reduce NHS hospital waiting lists by 2 million a year, 700,000 additional dental appointments, as well as the free breakfast clubs in primary schools that Bridget Phillipson spoke about last week. But we'll do that in an orderly way.
But Keir Starmer said, and says all the time, have the election in May, bring it on. That's in a matter of weeks. He says Labour's ready.
Yeah.
Now, this plan was well-trailed. You had a few weeks to think about it.
No,
you're not ready on that, are you?
Look, the government made their announcements on Wednesday. It is now Sunday. And I think your viewers would want to know that I was doing the work properly, that I wasn't just plucking numbers out of the air, but that I was methodically going through all the government documents to identify the funding streams so that all my sums add up. And I think if there's one thing that you and your viewers know about me is that everything in our manifesto will be fully costed and fully funded, including this plan. And I will do the work properly, as I always do, to make sure that our sums add up.
Will you accept another of Jeremy Hunt's measures, cutting capital gains tax on second home sales? Now, the government said they're going to do that to try to encourage people to sell up, to provide more homes for other people. Would you reverse that if you end up in power?
Well, if you look at the way that the Office of Budget Responsibility have costed that, they say that it brings in revenue, and I'm not going to undo a measure that would end up costing taxpayers
money. So you will accept that. OK, that's good to have that on the record. When it comes to capital gains, your colleague Angela Rayner has been facing questions about whether she should have paid capital gains when she sold her home back in 2015. The Chancellor even made a jibe about it in the budget. Now, she said she did nothing wrong, but I just wonder, have you talked to her about it? Have you asked her about it?
Well, Angela's a friend and a colleague, and she has made her representations on this, and that's good enough for me. And I think that people are ready to move on from that. But it's a bit rich for Jeremy Hunt, who owns multiple properties which he rents out, to make a jibe at Angela Rayner, who bought a council house and later sold it. I think that it's very, very different.
But one of her old neighbours has told the Times newspaper that she's not being straight about it. They said she's telling porkies. Have you asked her about it?
Well, look, I've seen the representations and what Angela has said. I have absolute faith in Angela. She's been very clear. She's taken advice and has explained the situation, and that's good enough for me.
While we're talking about Angela Rayner, her big plan, a big part of Labour's plan, is to really extend workers' rights. In fact, from day one, essentially give more or less the same rights to everybody, whether they're freelancers or whether they're somebody who's working part-time. Can you guarantee that that full package will be in the Labour manifesto?
Yes, we have committed to an extension of workers' rights, including banning zero-hour contracts, getting rid of fire and rehire, and having a real minimum wage. Obviously, the Low Pay Commission will set that. But this is a big extension of the rights of working people, because if an economy is not working for working people, it's not working at all. And at the moment, too many people are stuck in insecure, precarious work. We went into the pandemic with 11 million people having less than £100 worth of savings. That reflects not just low pay, but also terribly insecure work for too many people. We do want to change that, but of course we'll work with businesses to make sure that our plans work for them as well, including, for example, probation periods in employment contracts. So, we do want to make changes, but all of our plans are pro-business and pro-worker, because the two things are the two sides of the same coin.
But you've given a clear commitment on the record that you will have the full package in your manifesto, and that's interesting to hear. Let's look then at the bigger picture. Now, as you've already said, people know about you, you care about every single penny. You've said already, if you do make it into power, you'll inherit the worst set of public finances since World War II. You've also said many times, you're not going to borrow money for everyday spending. You've also said you're not going to put lots of taxes up. Now, let's be clear with everybody watching. That means that after the election, whoever wins, as Sharon said, there's basically going to be no extra cash for public services or very little, and that means real terms cuts to some government departments. Can you confirm today, if Labour wins the election, there will be real terms cuts to some government spending?
Well, it is clear that the inheritance that a Labour government would have if we do win the next election will be the worst since the Second World War. And I have to be honest that we're not going to be able to turn things around straight away. But we will get to work on all of that. And I have announced, Laura, an initial injection of cash into our struggling public services. There's the commitments around reducing NHS waiting lists and breakfast clubs at primary schools.
You can't tell us how you spend for, but just...
We will fund those pledges. But also, Laura, beyond that, we have said that we would extend the windfall tax on the big profits the energy giants are making, and we would invest that money in moving to the low-carbon industries of the future. But VAT and business rates on private schools and putting that money into the 93% of children at state schools.
But we're asking
taxing the private equity bosses to put more money into our public services.
But we're asking a really clear question here. Can you confirm today that in the first couple of years of a Labour government, some departments would face real terms cuts? Because people want to know, and our viewers sometimes feel like you're not giving enough information. This is what one of them wrote in to say, John Sinclair. He's asking, when will you come clean about how you'll deal with the abominable state of our national finances to support public services? So can you confirm today, if you want to be honest with people, that some government departments would face a real terms cut?
Well, at the moment, the government have not set out their plans by individual departments, so we haven't got a spending review. I will do a spending review quickly if we win the election, but that's not something that's possible to do from opposition. But I do know that public services need more money. That's why we will make that initial injection. But remember also, the Office of Budget Responsibility's forecasts are based on the government's plans, mm-hmm. and the government's plans do not include our comprehensive plan to grow the economy. Our national wealth fund is about bringing in private sector investment. That will mean more taxes paid. That will mean more money for public services.
And you've explained that, but that would take time. Well, and this is the important thing here. At the moment, and you explain this very clearly, that you want to stick to the same kind of spending rules that the Conservatives do as well. You don't want to put up lots of tax and you don't want to borrow for the day to day. And that leaves some people wondering what the difference is between your plans for the economy and the Conservatives' plan for the economy. I'd just like to play you a question from one of our viewers, Ian, a voter who we met a few months ago when we spoke to lots of viewers in Manchester. You can listen to this.
I'm normally a Labour voter, and I'd like to know what the difference is between the Conservative and Labour's fiscal policy, as I'm not seeing a very clear dividing line, especially since the...
Now, Ian's a Labour voter. He's asking you, what's the difference?
There's two clear differences. The first is the initial injection of cash into our public services by closing those tax loopholes and having a proper windfall tax on
the
energy companies.
Those are crumbs.
Wait a second.
Picture.
They're not crumbs. £1.5 billion for the VAT and business rates on private schools. £7.7 billion over the course of the Parliament by closing the loopholes, etc. So those are not crumbs. That is real money to go into our public services that the Conservatives aren't investing today. But second, in the end, you've got to grow the economy. This is the point that Andy Haldane was making on your programme last week. Mm-hmm. We need to get people back into work, ensure that they've got the skills to succeed and boost productivity. And our plans are about doing exactly that. The creation of the National Wealth Fund that we've spoken about this morning, businesses say that's why Aviva and Barclays have signed up to this task force. They say that there is the money ready to go if government put in place the right structures to unlock it. Reform of the planning system to get Britain building again, new homes and energy infrastructure as well, reforming the apprenticeship levy so we can get people the skills that they need. Now, some of these things take time and the full impact takes time. But if we can get building homes, 1.5 million in the first term of a Labour government, that is money going into the economy right away. And if the economy grows, you bring in tax revenues.
But you admit there yourself a lot of the things you want to do, and the full impact takes a while.
But you have an impact straight away.
But what many people want to understand, though, is given that you agree with the Conservatives on cutting national insurance, you're accepting that, you've ruled out raising income tax, you have the same rule to get debt down, which does constrict things, you've admitted that today. What is the big difference between the two parties' economic offer? Because lots of well-respected economists actually say when you look at it, essentially they're not that different. And the IFS, very well-respected think tank, for example, this week said, look, there's actually a conspiracy of silence between the two parties not being fully honest with the public about how tough things might be.
Well, I've said I'm under no illusions about the scale of the inheritance, and I do need to be honest that it's going to take a while to turn around the challenges that we see. And I think viewers recognise that, Sharon said, it's going to be the toughest job in politics. But I relish the chance because there's always choices to be made.
Well, and that's exactly the point. And yes. Andy Haldane, who you referenced, actually said last week, he said he thought you should be much more flexible about the spending rules. You could make that choice, and yet you've made a choice to stick to the same spending rules as the Conservatives.
I worked at the Bank of England, like Andy Haldane, for many years before I became an MP, and I feel that the importance of fiscal rules in providing a constraint in which governments act is incredibly important. You saw what happened when Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng tried to circumvent the fiscal rules. They didn't allow the Office for Budget Responsibility to report. They undermined the Bank of England. I won't do that because making sure that the sums add up, making sure that we start to get debt on a downward trajectory is important. But my fiscal rules are different from those of the government. We separate current and day-to-day expenditure from capital investment. That is important because business investment in the UK is lower than in any other G7 economy. We need that public investment to leverage in the private sector investment. But if we can grow our economy, we change the trade-offs that government have to make.
And it is about
that
choices,
is why. Yeah. But that is why growth is the number one mission of an incoming Labour government.
And if
because
you win,
that is the way we sustainably improve living standards and get the money that I know we desperately need. I know we desperately need for our public services.
And if you win, as you hope, and if you then get the economy growing, which is your ambition, what then would be Chancellor Rachel Reeves' instinct? If you have £7 billion that emerges from the economy, it could be a penny off income tax, or it could be £7 billion for colleges or courts. What's your instinct?
Well, look, I want taxes on working people to be lower, but you've always got to explain where the money comes from for that. But look, the thing that got me into politics in the first place was education and schools. I went to school in the 80s and 90s, the last time that we had a long period of Conservative government. And when I was in the sixth form, our sixth form was two prefab huts in a playground. Mm-hmm. Our school library was turned into a classroom because there were more students than there was space.
So services is your instinct rather than more
education. You know, when Tony Blair said education, 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 that's what got me involved in politics because I felt for the first time you had a political leader that was talking about the things that mattered to me and my family and my life. And the last Labour government turned around our schools and our hospitals. Mm-hmm. But for me, giving all children a good start in life, wherever they come from, whatever their background, and unlocking that potential that every child has, but it's not real for enough children in enough parts of the country. That is something that I feel absolutely passionate about.
OK, we are still a long way from the election, although it's this year, but, you know, a week's a long time in politics, so 6 or 7 months is an age. But if the polls are correct, if Labour wins and you become the Chancellor, your life's going to change an awful lot. Now, Keir Starmer's talked a bit about the pressures on family, whether or not he moves into number 10, he's concerned about his children's privacy. Have you thought about whether or not you would live above the shop if you're lucky enough to win?
Well, my kids are probably watching at the moment, so I prefer the first time they know about our future living arrangements to be when I'm talking to them rather than with you. But look, I recognise that it will be a big change for my family. I've got two primary school-aged children, but the opportunity to serve is what I came into politics to do. I've been an MP now for 14 years and all of them have been in opposition. I just want the chance to do what I believe I can do well, which is to run the public finances and the economy of the United Kingdom.
And one of your colleagues scurrilously told me that you care so much about not wasting anything. When you go to big business breakfasts, you get them to nick the pastries and the leftovers and take them back to the office. Is that true?
I don't think she said nick. I don't like waste. I don't like waste of expenditure. I don't like any waste. And so when you go to these events and there's all these pastries left out at the end, we ask whether we could take them back to the office and share them with colleagues. Living out my values in practice, no waste under a Rachel Reeves chancellorship.
There you go. Well, I'm sure you asked very politely, but very politely, it's always good to have you with us in the studio, Rachel Reeves. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Laura.
Well, are you convinced or critical? You can email me, kuenssberg@bbc.co.uk, or on social media, you can use the hashtag BBCLauraK, that's on X or on Instagram or wherever else all these things are these days. And the headlines are unfolding on the BBC Live page, as you can always follow along. Sharon, firstly to you then, what was your reaction to Rachel Reeves? Because she gave a hint that she would rather put money into services than cut tax, but she's very reluctant still to show a bit more ankle about some of her plans.
I mean, interesting, the focus on growth and productivity, which I think whoever wins the next election, I think is absolutely crucial. I think we're going to have to get really creative with the partnerships with business and business investment, just because there's so little room for any government, really, of whatever political complexion to spend more money. So it's great to hear her talking about leveraging business investment. I also think there's a role for business on public services. So we have a partnership. We're trying to be the employer of choice for young people from the care system. Interestingly, it was actually a feature of Jeremy Hunt's budget, doing more for the for younger people from disadvantaged groups. So I think the boundaries between the state and business will have to get much more connected, not just in terms of those sort of growth and infrastructure and investment, but actually how we think about public service reform.
So basically business is going to have to pick up some of this
slack. We're going to have to step in.
But is that, just briefly, is that really realistic? Because I have to say, I've heard lots of politicians over the years say lots of things like that. We'd like to have partnerships, we want to work more with business. Is it realistic that that could be a game changer?
I think it is inevitable. So, I mean, Rachel has talked today about new employment rights from day one for a new government. That's got profound implications for business. We're very positive, obviously, as a partnership about doing more for our workers, for our partners. But inevitably, and you've got lots of businesses, we already provide GP and mental health services because the state isn't as present as it was. And I think there has to be an open and honest conversation about how much the state can do and where the private sector needs to step in.
Michael, what did you make of what you heard then?
Well, I've got a lot of respect for Rachel Reeves because, unlike Keir Starmer, she refused to serve in Jeremy Corbyn's shadow cabinet at the time when Keir Starmer was urging us to make Jeremy Corbyn our next prime minister. The problem she's got, and you touched on it in your interview, is that Labour are committed to Angela Rayner's trade union reform package. That would make it easier for trade unions to go on strike and more difficult for employers to run their businesses. And that puts the kibosh on any hope of economic growth.
Really? Because Sharon said she's happy about it.
Well, I'm not sure that's exactly what Sharon said. But the truth is that it's the private sector that creates wealth. We need the private sector to prosper. We need employers to be able to run their businesses. And if you've got more strikes, you're not going to get economic growth.
Sharon,
it's very simple.
Briefly, on those reforms, is that something that concerns you as an employer?
I think if it's done in a common sense way in consultation with business, I think employees, as I say, now we don't call ourselves employees and partners, but having stability and confidence in your employment, and in the rights of your, the rights that are provided by your business, I think that is a potential.
But we know what they're committed to, and I bet something Rachel never mentions in her.
Well, it was interesting. Well, it was interesting. She gave a very clear commitment. It would be in the manifesto. But Hugh, now you are a Green campaigner. I think you're a member of the Green Party.
I am.
You listened to Jeremy Hunt this week. You listened to Rachel Reeves this morning. What did you think?
I am a member of the Green Party. I voted Labour when they promised things could only get better. But what I'm hearing today is things are only going to stay the same. What Labour's become very good at is ruling things out. They keep saying, well, we're going to... with some idea of somehow calming a stressed electorate, they keep ruling out things that would actually make me much more likely to vote for them. I mean, they've ruled out £28 billion on green energy. They've ruled out cancelling the new oil and gas licences, which are completely unnecessary and should be cancelled. They've ruled out proportional representation, even though their own membership voted for it at conference. They've ruled out working with the Progressive Coalition, working with the Green Party and the Lib Dems. And they've ruled out one thing that I think we should focus on for a minute, because we need to raise more tax revenue. We absolutely must. And it might surprise people to know that a lot of wealthy people are in favour of paying more tax. And a wealth tax, which has been costed by the Green Party, could raise £70 to £100 billion that could really be spent on projects that would make a difference.
But I think a lot of your viewers might say to you, Hugh, look, the tax burden is at nearly record highs. People are feeling really, really hard up.
I'm not talking about increasing the tax burden on anyone who's having a hard time. I'm talking about... what is the point of a Labour government if they can't bring together, narrow the difference between the extremely wealthy mm-hmm. and those who are experiencing food and fuel poverty mm-hmm. and finding life really difficult? So, only a wealth tax will do that.
So, Sharon, with your Treasury economist former hat on, if you put that on for a moment, would something like a wealth tax be realistic? Because on the right, you get people saying, actually, that would drive business away, it would have a negative effect, but... when you looked at it, I'm sure the Treasury's looked at it over the years, what effect would it have?
So, I mean, with my former hat on, I mean, if I were approaching a spending and tax review after the election, the things that worry you are the tax burden is high and getting higher. There's much less room to tax, but how do you do this in a way that's fair? So I think particularly as both a business person but also a Treasury economist, your worry is you don't want to drive the wealth creators that you need to support growth and support productivity.
Many of those wealth creators are on record as saying they're happy to pay more tax. It's a very interesting organisation called the Patriotic Millionaires. Have a look at their website. There's all sorts of things that could be done to take some of this extreme wealth and narrow the gap between the very rich and the poor in the UK.
Michael, is that something you think is realistic?
No, I think we've heard over the years these suggestions that you only tax the very rich. All these taxes, such as the one that Hugh's recommending, would go far down the ladder. They would hurt not just the very rich, they would hurt ordinary working people who may have been able to save something. They would hit people who've saved to own their own homes. They would have a disastrous effect on our economy because... too many people, for very many people, wealth is transferable and they would just leave the country. And the wealth creators, as Sharon has said, are the people that we need to make our economy grow.
Well, I know we'll be talking about tax a lot in the next few months as we get closer to the election. But just before we move on, Michael, there's a lot of discussion in this morning's papers. There's been a lot of discussion in the last few weeks about the nature of some of the protests in London and around the country. People been on the streets to support Palestine, but there have been, you know, fringe elements that many people have looked at and thought look very intimidating to some people, particularly to Jewish people. Now, as a Jewish former Home Secretary, do you believe that it's gone too far? Do you agree that actually sometimes London is a no-go area for Jews?
Yes, unfortunately, that is true. And this is an area where it's very difficult to get the balance right. The right to protest is undoubtedly a fundamental part of a free society, and we must maintain the right to protest. But it's also unacceptable that sections of our community think that our streets are no-go areas for them. So how you strike that balance, how you try and reconcile those two sometimes conflicting rights is a really, really difficult challenge. And I don't think we've quite got it right at the moment.
Well, we'll see. The government's, we expect, in the next few days going to announce some of their plans and how they handle that dilemma. Thank you, all three of you, so much for now. Now, imagine if your body stopped responding how you expect it to. Everyday tasks get a bit harder. That's what happened to Justin Curry, the lead singer of the band Delamitri, who knew something was wrong when he started having trouble holding his guitar plectrum on stage. With his diagnosis, he became one of 150,000 people in this country with Parkinson's. But he carried on performing without saying anything for a while, even not telling his mum to start with. But he's opening up now in a Radio 4 documentary that's on later today, and also to us, when I met him in Glasgow.
Spit in the rain, Delamitri.
You can grin, but you can't hide.
One of the nurses said, you can look at it as being a disease that means you can't really concentrate on two things at once. So things that are automatic, like playing the bass or strumming a guitar, all of a sudden aren't really automatic. You're having to focus on them and say to yourself, don't drop the plectrum, try not to skip. I mean, I wouldn't be able to sit here and play a song on the guitar because I would, my strumming might sort of break down. And I love the security of having the band behind me, and they've been incredibly supportive, sort of emotionally and professionally.
How does it feel for you, though? One of the things you say in the documentary that you've made about it is that applause is everything. Mm-hmm. And for as long as you can play well enough, the job's the best one in the world.
Yeah.
Now, of course, you can't play in the way that you used to be able to.
Yeah, you can, I can't play in the way I would expect to. And I know it will get worse at some... At what rate, nobody knows. But so I know I'm going to have to stop. Whereas formerly, people like me would never want to stop. You know, we'd want to be singing in a pub at the age of 80 or something, you know, and being dragged off by our grandchildren or something in embarrassment. So the idea of having to stop, that's quite grim.
One of the things in the documentary is you talk about then how you've been trying to make it work, mm-hmm. how you've learned to play in a slightly different way, mm-hmm. also how you've had to adjust how you sing.
Yeah, a bit.
Can you just tell us about that?
It's hard to know which is disease and which is just age, but there's definitely a bit of... I seem to have lost a bit of diaphragm control. Parkinson's generally makes you a bit feeble, and I think that's kind of affecting how I hit the notes. So it's harder for me now to get up there and get onto the note, whereas before I think that was a bit more... easy. I mean, singing is never easy, and it shouldn't be. Singing should be hard, but now I have to really, really concentrate. So you're in love with someone else, someone who burns within your soul, and it looks like I am the last to know.
Can you imagine a life, though, when you're not on stage?
Not having dates in the diary, the reality of that is... not good. I mean, if whenever we're in a position where we don't have something in the future booked, I feel completely rootless. I feel completely at sea because I don't have that appearance on stage in the future to be the sort of focus of everything in my life. So I'll need to find I'll need to go and do good deeds or something.
What kind of good deeds would you do?
I don't know. I feel some moral obligation to go in. Because I mean, I've led this incredibly selfish life, you know, where I've basically got to do whatever I want to do for most of it. You know, I've not had a boss since 1986 or something. So, I think it's. I'm going to have to grow up at some point.
Michael J. Fox, who everybody's familiar with his Parkinson's experience, he's talked about actually now, he believes. It's been a gift to him.
Yeah, I can see that argument.
What do you think of that argument?
I mean, it's already changed my personality in not necessarily negative ways.
How so?
Well, you know, any form of disability, you become aware of disability in general, and you become acutely aware of that line that disabled people have been saying for years, that there aren't able-bodied people, there just are a lot of people who are not yet disabled. So, and I quite like that. I quite like the idea that we're all going to go through some of these difficulties at some point in life, and I'm just much more aware of the kind of needs and the kind of space that people need when they're struggling to move about. You can't go.
Do you think you've learned anything about the sort of human spirit of just getting on? You know, you're someone who's had this massive career, huge energy on stage, huge talent in writing songs that have made millions of people happy. Well, and then this diagnosis has made you vulnerable.
Yeah, I mean, I understand the nature of hubris, I think, because you do think you're invulnerable until something proves you're not. You notice that ridiculous cliche, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. No, that's not true. If you lose a leg, you're not stronger. And I am not stronger for having Parkinson's, believe you me.
I'm very struck by how you're very, not just very fatalistic, but actually very positive about it.
In bleaker days, it gets on top of you, you know, and I'm sure everybody will say that. But there are surprisingly long moments of reprieve.
Justin, that's great. Thank you so much for speaking
to us.
Thanks,
Laura. My pleasure. Thank you.
And Justin's programme, Tremolo, is on Radio 4 later today at 4:30. And, of course, it's on BBC Sounds. Now, there's almost nothing that worries voters more than the state of the health service. Right now, patchy at best, grim at worst. Even the Prime Minister himself admitted this in a recent interview.
NHS waiting lists.
We have not made enough progress.
You failed on that pledge.
Yes.
Well, Victoria Atkins is the Health Secretary in charge of the health in England. She's with us this morning. Do you agree with the Prime Minister? You've failed.
We have set this target because we get it. You know, I use the NHS and proudly have done since the age of three when I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. I absolutely understand why people are so worried about this. We have set it as a clear priority for the whole of government, but particularly, obviously, for my department. And although over the last 3 months we have seen waiting lists come down, of course we want to do much more. Interestingly, we know that for the longest waits, they are concentrated in just 15 trusts. And so, as well as tackling the problem nationally, we have made concerted efforts to try to support those 15 trusts to get those longest waiting patients looked after so that we can reduce the lists in that way as well.
Do you agree with the Prime Minister that you have failed?
Yeah, and we also acknowledge that as well as putting extra funding into dealing with the electives, we have a recovery plan that, as I say, we are making progress on. We have also got to acknowledge the impact that strikes have had, 1.4 million appointments cancelled in the last year. Mm-hmm. But against that background, nonetheless, the NHS has managed to reduce waiting lists over the last 3 months, which is a significant
from fairly appalling levels, and our viewers tell us that all the time.
Very much so, and I acknowledge that, which is why it is a priority.
But one of the things that's curious about what's happened is, according to official statistics, the health service is still less productive than it was before the pandemic. Now, in normal terms, that means essentially it's doing less and getting more money. What's gone wrong?
Not only are we investing record amounts, we have more doctors, more nurses, more midwives working in the NHS.
And we're getting less.
Exactly right, which is why this Wednesday, the Chancellor announced not just tax cuts for 29 million workers. He didn't just announce changes to the high income child benefit charge that will help nearly 500,000 families. He also announced a £3.4 billion productivity plan for the NHS, because the NHS is one of our, it's our largest spending department in that regard. It's a critical and incredibly important public service. And we know that whilst a strong economy helps pay for the NHS, equally, a strong and productive NHS helps a growing economy. And so I'm really excited about these very ambitious plans to not just gear up basic technology across our hospital trusts to make sure that doctors and nurses are able to work with the best technology day to day, but also using AI to help with scans, for example, so that we're really bringing the NHS into the 21st
century. But, Health Secretary, there's a repairs backlog of £11 billion. We know, and we've talked about it on the show before, we've shown images on the show before that I think we can remind people of today. There are hospitals where there are buckets out catching drips. There is scaffolding up, propping up roofs. Don't you have to fix the roof before you start worrying about robots?
Very much so. And by the way, I think we can do both at the same time, not least because that's exactly what we're doing. So on Thursday, I went to visit Heatherwood Hospital, that is a brand new community diagnostic centre with it's a surgical specialist centre, in fact. And we see there they are a paperless hospital. They use AI and they have specialist electronic patient records.
The question here is about what has been allowed to develop. Because you have got an £11 billion backlog of repairs in the health service. There are hospitals where roofs are being held up by scaffoldings and their buckets catching drips in corridors. Was it a mistake for successive Tory governments to take money from what's called the capital budget, the budget to fix things, in order to put it onto day-to-day spending? Because that's what happened year after year after year. Was that a mistake?
So let me just help with the numbers there. So we acknowledging the problems that some of our ageing buildings have. You know, the NHS is celebrated its 75th anniversary last year. Of course, we have older buildings. We want to modernise those, which is partly why we have the new hospitals programme, building 40 hospitals
which
by the end of the decade.
Which is not building 40 new hospitals, as your predecessor admitted. But my question here is a clear one. Was it a mistake for successive Conservative governments to take money from the pot that was allocated for buildings, for capital investment, as it's called, and to use it on day-to-day costs. Was that a mistake? Because many experts in this sector think that's what's gone wrong.
So to help with that as well, we've also, of course, had the acknowledgement about RAC, and so we have a specific programme to try to drive RAC out of those hospitals that, like many other public buildings, have them in, and we are on train to do that. But we have also committed this year alone some £4.2 billion to maintenance and infrastructure.
Our question was whether it was a mistake that you haven't done that in successive years, and our viewers will hear that you don't want to address that this morning.
But in fairness as well, it's for integrated care boards at local level to apportion that money to the buildings. They have my complete support to do so, because I absolutely understand the problems that your viewers are raising.
All right, there are so many things we could talk about, but one thing today, you are announcing some new money for maternity care. Now, the number of women dying in maternity care has gone up on the Conservatives' watch. There have been a shocking number of cases, a shocking number of hospitals where this has become a really acute problem, East Kent or Nottingham, to mention just a couple of them. Are you ashamed that that has been allowed to happen?
Look, as Health Secretary, I have prioritised women's health, particularly maternity services, because, you know, I had my baby on the NHS. I know that the NHS can do wonderful work, but there are also some darker corners that on which
and
we must
worse.
Shine a light. Well, actually, and it's very difficult to talk about this, because I appreciate this day of all days, there will be people at home watching this who have been very, very badly affected by this in their own families. But if we look at the figures, and it's very difficult to talk about figures in such a sensitive subject, but actually we see that the rate of neonatal and stillbirths is happily declining. In other words, fewer are happening, and we have a clear target to reduce those by 50% in 2025. This is why this package of support is so important, because as well as the tax cuts and the productivity plan for the NHS, we are also investing further in areas that we know make a real difference. So we're investing in more midwives, but we are also importantly rolling out training for 6,000 staff across England to help with neonatal resuscitation, because that is such a delicate and careful operation to undertake. And in addition to that, we're helping roll out some really significant pilots that we've tried to help with brain injury, because again, that is a significant factor that we want to reduce and stop.
Something else that is very significant in terms of the pressure it puts on the NHS is a subject that one of our panellists is very passionate about, tackling obesity and helping people look after their health a bit better. And Hugh, you have a direct question for the Health Secretary on this.
I do. The subject is obesity, and it's interesting, Secretary of State, you haven't mentioned it at all. It's the single biggest factor in the ailing health of the nation. Treating obesity is the single biggest cost to the NHS. We've got approaching 3 million people who are long-term sick. The estimated cost to the economy of obesity is £100 billion a year. Now, I've worked with many amazing agencies, with the Food Foundation, with the Obesity Health Alliance, with Jamie Oliver and his team, with Henry Dimbleby. They have all put a raft of policies, of levers that you could be pulling to address the obesity crisis. You're not pulling any of them. You've done next to nothing to help this ailing, struggling six citizens of the UK find healthier food.
OK, well, let's put that
next to
you.
Next to nothing
so,
about
Victoria,
it.
Victoria, let's respond then.
I've been in post for 3 months now, and what I want to do is set out, and I will be over the coming weeks, setting out a prevention strategy, which, of course, will include obesity. But we make the mistake, I think, of siloing obesity by itself. We know that it can have many, many other conditions, including causing type 2 diabetes. And so over the coming weeks, you will see the government set out our plans. But I want to take a strategic approach. In fairness, Hugh asked me this question. I want to take a strategic approach to prevention. And in fact, the biggest public health intervention we can make, we are making, which is creating the first smoke-free generation. We know that that will save up to 4 in 10 cancers that are caused by smoking.
But in terms of,
and with the enormous personal
But in terms of obesity,
cost.
Though, there is a list of moments in recent history when governments have had the chance to act and they haven't. For example, rules banning multi-buy deals on food and drinks high in fat and salt. That's going to be delayed for another 2 years. It was on the books and then delayed till October 2025. You're reviewing that now. You've also delayed a pre-watershed TV and online ad ban on junk food ads from 2025. There is a list of moments when you almost acted and then you decided not to.
But this is where we've got to reflect the society in which we serve and which the NHS serves. This is why I come back to the productivity plan, because that is £3.4 billion worth of investment, not just in basic tech for doctors and nurses in and around the wards. It's also about
fax
updating...
machines being used in
exactly
the NHS,
right,
Health Secretary.
And this is precisely
In 2024, there are fax machines being used in the Health Service.
We have a fully funded plan to deal with this, in direct contrast, I may say, to the £30 billion worth of debt that the Shadow Chancellor has talked about today that Labour Party policies have no funding for. But so we have an investment on basic tech, but I also want us to seize the opportunities of AI. We have to do this in a way that is trusted by patients and by clinicians, but we need to do this. And there are, for example, the NHS app. At the moment, we have 3 out of 4 adults with that app on their phones. That is, you know, any tech company would be very pleased with that. We've just made it, we've expanded it so that we can have our repeat prescriptions on this app. That saves us as patients 18 minutes on average each time, saves GPs 3 minutes as well. But I think that app, we can do far, far more with that. And we will be able to, as we have begun to roll out talking therapies and so on through that app, believe you me, that app is the way that we're going to be able to address some of the issues that Hugh rightly raises, because we have to take responsibility for our health. We you know, as part of the productivity plan, we cannot keep throwing, you know, investing money in the NHS in a way that we're not getting those productivity returns back. We need to turn that conversation around and say, we want to invest in the NHS, but we have to do so in a way that is productive.
It might not be much use to many of our viewers watching this to have an app if when they go to hospital, there aren't enough doctors there. You mentioned the strikes as being part of the reason why waiting lists are where they're at. Junior doctors are still without an agreement with you. Could there be a deal soon? Will you give them more money?
So, look, first of all, can I thank the Consultants Committee of the BMA and the HCSA, because...
Are you going to get a deal with the junior doctors? We're short of time.
We narrowly missed getting the consultants deal over the line. We have a new deal they're recommending to their members, and I very much hope they will feel able to accept it. With junior doctors, I want to do a deal. And I have... What was so regrettable was they walked out of our negotiations at the end of last year. I want to do a deal. They have to come back with some reasonable expectations. And by the way, I don't just want to talk about pay, important though that is. I also want to talk about working conditions, about their well-being across the health workforce, because the NHS looks after us. It also needs to look after its members of
staff.
So
the ball's in their court to come back to you.
We of course, I'm keeping the channels open. Of course I am. But I think, you know, we have got to have some realism as to what the taxpayer can afford to pay.
OK, Health Secretary Victoria Atkins, always great to have
you
in
this
studio. Thank you very much indeed for being here. Well, straight away, Hugh, you asked her a question about a lack of obesity strategy in your view. What did you make of her answer?
Well, I didn't hear any obesity strategy. I sat down with Jeremy Hunt in 2018 when we made Britain's Fat Fight for the BBC. I had to chase him a long time to get the interview, but when we had...
Literally?
Literally, actually, at the Conservative conference. Absolutely literally. He actually physically ran away from me at one point, but finally he agreed to give an interview, and in it... He said, and you can hold me to account. And I rewatched it yesterday. You can hold me to account on this. It is our stated aim to reduce childhood obesity in the UK by 50%. Now, I just heard the minister make another claim of reducing infant mortality by 50%. I would say be very, very wary of a Tory minister promising you to reduce anything by 50%, because they've done nothing. They haven't made a tiny dent. We're exactly halfway through, but 2030 was the date, 2018 was the interview, we're 2024, we're 6 years in, they've done nothing. And you absolutely rightly pointed out there's a whole raft of policy levers they could be pulling. If they were serious about tackling obesity, they'd be pulling all of them.
OK, well, let's see what she says this week. She's promising a prevention strategy, so we'll look at that carefully when it emerges. Well, I'm sure you'll have views on that, Hugh, but thank you. Our main quest this morning, though, was to talk about the economy, and we've been asking if Labour sums added up with Rachel Reeves. You've been getting in touch, as we love you to do. Yvonne Davidson said, hearing Rachel Reeves filled me with hope for Britain's future. She'll be pleased to hear that. Enthusiasm and realism, she talked about. But Paul in Derbyshire said, Labour are just not giving any alternatives. alternative plans to the Tories. Sharon, if you were in their position, you know, you've got lots of experience of running business, you know what it's like being in government, so you understand the economy probably quite likely better than any of the politicians, perhaps. What is the one thing that you would do if you were in their shoes?
I think with so little money to spend, probably the biggest thing I would do was really to tackle planning.
Really, it's planning reform?
Planning reform. You know, cross-party consensus. You need to do it early. You've got to take bravery and courage. But to get Britain building again and homes for our young people, that's what I would come out of the blocks with on day one.
Michael, it's interesting that Sharon mentions planning because politicians always mention this. And then it runs into the sand when their own MPs and their own members don't like what it means for them in real life.
Yes, it's a very difficult issue. I think productivity is the key to all this, as Victoria was saying. We can't keep on putting more and more taxpayers' money into our public services without improved performance. Mm. I listened to an interview last week with Abby Tierney. She is the woman who turned round the passport office. She's now gone to Welsh Rugby, and as a proud Welshman, I hope she does for Welsh Rugby what she did for the passport office. But she made it clear that there is enormous scope for improvements in productivity across our public services. They can really do much, much more than they're doing. If the rest of our schools, hospitals and police forces operated in the same way as the best, then that could be transformational.
But why is it so patchy then? Because I've heard politicians talk about productivity forever.
Yeah, it is difficult, but that's why I was so heartened by the amount of money that the Chancellor made available in the budget to use technology to improve productivity in the health service. I think that is a real game changer. And if we can do that, not only in the health service, but across our public services, they will be transformed.
Hugh, now you're no fan of, I mean, either of the big parties, really, but particularly not the Conservatives. But is there a point here, actually, what we have to do, what everyone has to do, Sharon suggested consensus, is have a proper good look at spending taxpayers' money more wisely, being more careful with it?
Of course we have to spend it more wisely. And part of that is spending it on the green economy. Because we have to make that transition, and the longer we leave it, the more expensive it will get. So if any sector is wise to spend on, it's a transition to the green economy. And Labour's now shrunk back from that. The Tories haven't been doing it anyway. So it's a real concern that this isn't getting the attention it needs.
Sharon, just lastly to you, John Lewis, results coming this week. I know you've had quite a tricky time when you've been there, but the results this week, are you optimistic, looking to have a good day back in the black?
I'm feeling very hopeful. We're making progress.
And job cuts on the horizon? You've talked about bold changes coming.
Yeah, we're having to take some... I mean, it's interesting, the conversation we've just had about public services and productivity, and it's something that every business is doing. We're trying to sort of simplify the way we work so that our partners, our amazing partners who've worked so hard over the last year, have got more time in front of customers is the way we're trying to do it.
OK, well, we've very much enjoyed having all three of you give us your time on this Sunday morning. Thank you all very much indeed for being with us. Huge thanks to my panel. Huge thank you, of course, to you for watching. And also thank you for sending in your questions and your messages. The main political parties might not share the same instincts, but they do right now share the same big picture view that they have to stick to spending limits that might mean more years when public services are squeezed. We heard Rachel Reeves tell us that a Labour government, if they win, won't be able to do everything they want to do straight away. But she stressed again her promise above all else to keep track of the chequebook. She knows the Tories will be watching her for any hint of stray pennies. You can watch our interview or anything else from today again on iPlayer. You can catch more on Newscast later on BBC Sounds. Or I will look forward to seeing you next week, same time, same place. And happy Mother's Day to everybody watching. Goodbye for now.